Let me tell you about the night that I met Arnold Schwarzenegger. Well, he met me. I've been open air preaching in Santa Monica, 3rd Street Promenade.
God has written this law upon your heart, you're not sworn to kill. But Jesus said this, if you get angry without cause, you're in danger of judgment. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer. Folks, if you advocate abortion, you're sinning against God. If you've had an abortion, you have murdered your offspring. The Bible says, what a man sows, that will he reap. If you sow to sin, you'll reap death and hell. You're made righteous by God, you'll reap life everlasting. That's the choice you've got.
Just finished, and I saw Arnold Schwarzenegger and his then wife walk by. So I thought I'd follow them, because wise men follow stars. Then I noticed they'd gone into the Gap clothing store. So I snuck around the other side, a back door, got in, saw him walking towards me, and reached out to give him a gospel tract. And you know what he said? He said, no! Of course I backed down because I didn't want to intimidate him with my physique. I'd become starstruck and I'd forgotten etiquette. I never give someone a gospel tract without a warm greeting, without a smile. When I see a stranger to whom I want to give a gospel tract, I normally smile at them, greet them and say, hi, how you doing? Did you get one of these? I forgot to do that with Arnie. That one word from Arnold has stayed with me since that day and reminded me to always give a stranger the courtesy of a greeting. Fortunately, about 10 minutes later, a member of our outreach team hooked up with Arnold and his wife Maria, and he got to share the gospel with them. He was only an 11-year-old kid, very brilliant kid. When Jesus sat on the well, he didn't begin talking to her about her adultery. She had transgressed the seventh commandment. But Jesus didn't begin in that realm. He said, woman, give me a drink. He began in the natural. Why? Because the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God, and their foolishness to him because they're spiritually understood. I like people to feel a little bit of sanity before I give them a gospel tract. And a warm greeting can actually do that. A smile can do that. I guess one of the most common questions I'm asked is, how do I get to share the gospel with a stranger? As I said, I begin in the natural realm, and this is the way I do it. Let's say there's someone sitting on a seat just in front of me. I don't know who they are. I ignore my fears. My natural mind turns Zacchaeus into a Goliath. I'm nervous, but I ignore that. We've got to forget about ourselves. So I walk up to this guy and say, hi, how you doing? He might say, I'm doing good. Say, some nice weather, huh? It's the natural. I say, what's your name? I'm Ray. Shake his hand. Oh, give a fist bump. He says, his name's Eric. I say, hey, Eric. He says, what's up? I say, I got a question for you. He says, what? Do you think there's an afterlife? Now, I haven't mentioned God, Jesus, the Bible, heaven, hell, all those things that make him and us feel a little uncomfortable. I've just asked for his opinion. Do you think there's an afterlife? That has been my big deflator of the fear of man, knowing that I can do that. And I go with the confidence that I'm going to address his conscience. I'm not going to argue with his carnal mind, because Romans 8 verse 7 says the carnal mind is at enmity to God, for is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So the carnal, natural mind of man is in a state of hostility, so evidenced by the fact that people blaspheme the name of the God that gave him life, use his name as a cuss word. That shows the enmity that's there. So I avoid the carnal mind. After I've greeted him, talked about the weather, asked him about if there's an afterlife, then I go to the conscience. I say, well, are you going to make it to heaven? Are you a good person? He says, yeah, I think I'm a good person. Most every man will proclaim his own goodness, scripture tells us. So then I say, well, have you kept the commandments? This is what Jesus did in Mark 10, verse 17, with the rich young ruler. He gave the commandments to bring the knowledge of sin. It's what Paul did in Romans chapter 2. You who say you shall not steal, do you steal? You who say you shall not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? So you can do this. You just greet strangers, show genuine warmth, begin in the natural, swing to the spiritual, do what Jesus did, and address the conscience using the law, the Ten Commandments, which bring a knowledge of sin, and prepare the way for the Savior. Okay, now watch this. Years ago in Hollywood, if someone wanted to become an actor, they had to have a good speaking voice, be a good actor, and their name had to be memorable. When Arnold Schwarzenegger came along, he destroyed those three rules. Couldn't pronounce his name, he couldn't act, his accent was so thick it just didn't work, but it didn't matter, he could break the rules because he had the goods. He had a body that was shaped like an inverted doorknob. When you and I pick up a book, if the book doesn't grip us within the first two or three pages, it's a waste of time. An author knows that, he's got to grip the reader. But the New Testament breaks the rules. It starts off with genealogies, names you can hardly pronounce, let alone remember. It can do it because it's got the goods. It tells us how we can find everlasting life. What do you think that way is?
For one, always living every day, trying to do good, not just for yourself, but for others.
Ever heard the Bible verse, the wages of sin is death?
I have not.
Yeah, it's a famous verse. Death is what God pays you in for your sins. You're going to die because you've sinned against God. That's what the Bible teaches. Like a judge will give the death sentence to a heinous criminal that's murdered three girls. They say, you've earned this. Mm-hmm. This is your wages. This is what's due to you. This is what we're paying you. We're going to put you to death. And sin is so serious to a holy God, he's given us the death sentence. Now here's the big question. Do you think you're bad enough for God to put you to death for your sins?
No, not at all.
You think you're a good person?
Yes.
What's the standard you judge yourself by? Because most people think they're good people. What's the criteria for goodness?
Treating everybody with respect.
Is that what you do?
Yes.
Have you ever lied to another person?
I have. I'm not going to lie. I have. I feel like that's impossible not to do in, you know, just living in this world. It's just bound to happen.
Have you ever stolen from another person in your whole life?
Yes, probably. Pretty sure.
Probably.
I can't remember exactly when, but yes, I'm pretty sure I have.
So it's happened so many times you've forgotten? Have you ever used God's name in vain?
I have.
Would you use your mother's name as a cuss word?
No.
Why not?
It's, for one, it's a sin, but I just don't like using my mom as a cuss word.
If you hit your thumb with a hammer and you want to use a filth word to express disgust, beginning with S, to use her name as a substitute and equate it with that word would be horrible.
Yeah.
And yet you've done it with the God who gave you your mother and gave you life.
Right.
It's called blasphemy, Michael. It's so serious, it's punishable by death in the Old Testament. I appreciate your patience and your honesty.
Yeah, of course.
Jesus said, if you look at a woman and lust for her, you commit adultery with her in your heart. Have you ever looked at a woman with lust?
I have.
Have you had sex before marriage?
Yes.
Okay, so here's the question. You've told me you're a lying, thieving, blasphemous, fornicating, adulterer at heart, and you have to face God on Judgment Day. If he judges you by the Ten Commandments, you're going to be innocent or guilty?
In my like perspective, you know, if you repent those things before at least get up there, I think he will allow you to live with him in the afterlife.
Let me ask you again. If God judges you by the Ten Commandments on Judgment Day, mm-hmm. bearing in mind you're a self-admitted, lying, thieving, blasphemous, fornicating, adulterer at heart, will you be innocent or guilty on Judgment Day?
Probably guilty.
Heaven or hell?
Hell, maybe, yeah.
You've earned your wages. Can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
You're in big trouble on Judgment Day.
Yeah.
And what you're doing is what most people do. They rest in the thought that they can repent before God, and the Bible says, no, that won't help you. I'll tell you why. If you're in court and you've committed a very serious crime, like you've robbed a bank, shot a guard, and he died, the judge says you're guilty, you say, yeah, judge, I'm guilty, but I want to tell you I'm really sorry, and I'll never do it again. Yeah, the judge will say, of course you should be sorry, and of course you shouldn't do it again. So repentance can't save you in an earthly court. You're going to jail if you're sorry or not, you're going to do it again or not. It's exactly the same with God. You can't rely on repentance as a means of salvation. If you die in your sins, you go to hell, and there's only one thing you can do to be saved. Do you know what it is?
No.
This is the teaching of the New Testament we mentioned earlier on. It's to call upon God's mercy. You know, if you're in court and you can't justify yourself, you call upon the mercy of the judge. And the Bible says God is rich in mercy to all that call upon him. Now, do you know what God did for guilty sinners so we wouldn't have to go to hell?
He paid for their sins.
Yeah, he died on the cross. God became a person. Jesus was God manifest in the flesh, the express image of the invisible God. And he gave his life on the cross so we could be forgiven. Like a judge will let you go from a court, even though you're guilty, if someone pays your fine. He says, hey, someone's paid this fine, the speeding fine, so you're out of here. And you can walk, even though you're guilty, because someone paid your fine. And you and I can live forever. God can dismiss us from his court on Judgment Day, not on the basis of us doing anything or our repentance, but because he's good and kind and he provided a way of escape. He paid the fine. That's why Jesus said, it is finished, died for the sin of the world, suffered for us, rose again on the third day. And Michael, if you'll simply repent of those sins that you wouldn't acknowledge at first, but of those sins that have been uncovered today, say, God, I've used your name as a cuss word. I've fornicated and I've looked at pornography and lied and stolen and looked with lust. Please forgive me. Bible says he's rich in mercy to all that call upon him. And if you come to him with a contrite heart, do you know what contrite means?
No.
Contrition is when you're sorry for your sins. When you're truly, that's what a judge looks for in a criminal. If a judge looks at an arrogant, proud, self-righteous criminal, he's going to throw the book at him. But if he sees that he's genuinely sorry for his crimes and he's shedding a tear for what he did, he's going to give him mercy on the basis of his contrition. And the Bible says, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a contrite heart. In other words, God won't despise you if you come with a humble, sincere attitude. Say, God, I'm sorry for sinning against you. And the minute you put your faith in Jesus, God will reckon his righteousness to you. In other words, he'll wash you clean of your sins, clothe you in righteousness, and grant you the gift of everlasting life. Now, do you believe what I'm saying?
Yes.
When are you going to repent and trust in Christ?
Probably like starting after today.
After today or now?
Now, honestly.
Mike, can I pray with you?
Sure.
Father, I pray for Mike. Thank you for his openness and his honesty today, and as he considers the claims of the gospel, the fact that he sinned against you, headed for hell, and he considers what you did on the cross, may his heart be broken. May he realize the cost, the expense you went to for his forgiveness, and may he come to you with a tear of sorrow and find a place of true repentance and faith in Jesus, and this day pass from death to life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Michael, can I give you a book that I've written called How to Be Free from the Fear of Death?
Yeah.
Here it comes.
Thank you.
Will you read it?
Definitely, yes. I've been trying to get it.
The Evidence Study Bible will give you everything you've ever wanted to know about subjects such as the theory of evolution, as well as valuable information about cults and different religions, atheism, and biblical archaeology. It also contains hundreds of quality quotes, fascinating articles, amazing scientific facts in the Bible, and so much more. It even includes answers to 200 of the most commonly asked questions of the Christian faith. The Evidence Study Bible will thoroughly enrich your trust in God and in His precious Word. Get yours at livingwaters.com. Approaching a stranger is a little bit scary for most of us. That's why we've produced the Starter Kit. It contains four of our most popular gospel tracks. This is 101 of the world's funniest one-liners. These really are funny, and the gospel is hidden way inside. It's so easy to give out. You simply say, this is 101 of the world's funniest one-liners. It'll cheer up your day. This is the good person test. It's exactly what I say to people in comic form. And who can resist a comic? This is the Ten Commandments coin with a gospel on the back. I tossed a handful to teenagers once on a sidewalk and watched them fight over them. It's a great gift to give to anyone. And of course, our ever-popular million-dollar bill. Just say, did you get your million? And watch people's faces light up. There's a total of 350 tracks in the Starter Kit. Get yours today at livingwaters.com.